There once was a ship that put to sea, and the name of the ship was the Billy O.T. The winds blew harder, bowed it down below, my bully boys blow. Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go. She'd
not been too- The Dutch ship, the Amsterdam, was wrecked off the Hastings coast on the 26th of January, 1749, on her maiden voyage. She was built in 1748 by the Dutch company VOC, the Dutch East Indies Company. VOC are still reckoned to be the largest company ever formed, with a turnover reckoned in current day values to be $7.9 trillion. Most of the larger European countries had their own version of the East Indies Company and sought to do trade because the likes of silk and spices had become a big thing and were very, very profitable. In fact, one of the most profitable products was tea. Anyway, the Amsterdam tried on three different occasions to leave the port on Texel, which is one of the Frisian islands that circle part of the Netherlands. Three times they were brought back to port due to the inclement conditions and the storm that had been raging for some time. Finally, they left on the 6th of January. The ship was approximately 42.5 metres long, weighed 1,100 tonnes gross, and was three-masted, 11.5 metres wide, with 54 guns. It was called a mirror return ship because of the shape at the back of the ship resembled a handheld mirror of the time. The crew comprised the captain, William Crump, who was 33 years old and had a wife, Margareta, a four-year-old daughter, Elizabeth, and a four-month-old son, Conrad. His pay was 72 guilds a month, which had remained approximately the same for the last 100 years for captains. There were two further officers and a crew of 203 sailors, 127 soldiers, and five passengers. The crew would have been divided into three divisions of about 100 for 3 4-hour watches. The crew were made up of these soldiers and sailors, and these were not professional men. They were men who'd ended up in Amsterdam from various different European countries in very poor, wretched condition, who had nothing. And they were bought up, and I think that's the right term, by people known as soul sellers. These were men who would actually accommodate these poor wretches in very cramped, unhygienic conditions and feed them almost nothing. But when a boat came up that was suitable, they would put the sailors and soldiers on this boat. The soldiers and sailors were paid approximately 120 guilds a year. The soul sellers, though, charged them 150 guilds a year for when they came back and were put in these damp, squalid conditions. Many of them died, but the soul sellers still made huge profits. The company had no real respect for any of them. They described them thus: like wild boars, they rob and get drunk, go whoring. They must be treated like wild animals. Any show of reluctance would be treated with a rope end or a cat of nine tails. Punishment for wrongdoings at this time would include, for example, if you were caught stealing, your hand might be nailed to the mast. No idea for how long. Brawling, you might get 50 lashes. Homosexuality, you would be tied to your friend and thrown overboard. For murder, you would be tied to the victim and thrown overboard. It was not an easy time. You would get three meals a day, but we're talking porridge of crushed oats, barley or wheat. The passengers and officers obviously would eat relatively normal food. The passengers comprised one André von Bockum, junior merchant with the VOC, who was entitled to take his wife, Pieternella. They were joined by her sister Katerina, which was not normally allowed, but they had Katerina pretending to be a maid, which meant she was acceptable. Certain changes were allowed under fairly lenient rules. The other two passengers were an army lieutenant or lieutenant, Jacob Hall, 36, and his illiterate wife, Maria Moss, who was of poor breeding, according to accounts. Life was harsh and discipline was severe. They reckon probably two-thirds of the cargo remains buried under the sand. And of that, much of it would have been personal belongings. Originally, the cargo comprised silver bullion, of which there were 28 chests, 24 would be containing 50 wedge-shaped silver ingots each, and the other four contained about 16,000 silver ducatoons. They would also have had textiles, wine, stone ballast, cannon, paper, pens, pipes, domestic goods, and textile cloths, as we said. The whole cargo with the ship would be worth several million euros in modern currency. It's worth mentioning that the many officers and senior crew members used to supplement their income by borrowing money and buying goods to take out, and then buying more goods to return with. We know that Captain Klump, for example, borrowed in the region of 30,000 guilders for that very purpose. By the 16th of January, the ship was floundering around off the coast of Kent. More and more men became ill and were dying off at the rate of 5 per day. They weren't able to cook or use the head, which is the nautical term for toilet, because they would have been washed overboard. Conditions were that severe. In fact, to give you an idea, in Appledore, sea defences were smashed and a whole row of cottages behind the sea defences were washed away with people drowning. In Gosport, four warships broke free from safe harbour. One took 100 men to refloat. Apparently a lot of low-lying Hastings was underwater. By the 23rd, the Amsterdam was off Pevensey, and that was when her rudder was snapped off and she drifted helplessly back towards Bexhill and Hastings. Eventually, she dropped anchor off Hastings. By this time, 50 men were dead, with another 40 in a bad way. At one point, presumably during a lull in the storm, a boatload of Hastings fishermen, oblique pirates, oblique smugglers, went out to offer help, which was refused. Fear of salvage riots and piracy uppermost in Klump's mind. The citizens of Hastings were watching events, though, with a morbid fascination. The crew were sick and desperate. Some of them broke into the alcohol store and got very drunk. They then almost mutinied and demanded that Captain Klump beach the ship, which he agreed to do. He had little choice. They must have jury-rigged a rudder to achieve this. So, on 26th of January, Sunday, approximately 3 p.m, and we know this for reasons which I will explain. The first person to see them was allegedly Sir Charles Eversfield, who was riding his horse on shore. As he drew closer, he was disgusted to hear the sound of drunken sea shanties being sung. We have some very detailed contemporary records of what happened next because of a Hastings man who was convalescing in Bath. John Collier was a solicitor and secretary to the Duke of Newcastle, who in turn was also the Admiral of the Sussex coast. Collier had also served as town clerk and been mayor 5 times. He was friendly with the Prime Minister, Henry Pelham, who was also the Duke of Newcastle's elder brother. On the 1st of October in 1748, he was seized by an apoplectic fit and the palsy, probably a stroke, which deprived him of the use of the left side of his body, hence travelling to Bath to take the restorative waters. He charged his many friends there to keep him, in Hastings that is, to keep him well briefed as to any news happening, which fortunately they did, as there is no official record of the Wreck of the Amsterdam whatsoever. It was John Collier's brother-in-law, Thomas Smith, a customs officer who with his wife was in the early service at St Clement's Church, who reported the firing of cannon at exactly 3 p.m. Having beached the ship, Klump's next biggest problem was to protect the silver bullion. He tried to rally the crew to help. Obviously, in their drunken state, they demanded that he agree to give them a 10% share of the bullion as salvage to pay for their help. Klump had little choice and did agree verbally. Fortunately, they never asked for a written agreement. As the tide receded, Klump negotiated with the mayor, William Thorpe, for removal of the crew and the passengers and to guard the cargo. The mayor then sent off to get some troops down to do that, but that was going to take a while. Many of the crew managed to climb down the side and the passengers, and some 46 seamen were disembarked using a cat's cradle. The passengers were taken to the Maidenhead Inn on Hastings High Street, where they were comfortably looked after. At this point, all looked good, but then a man called Anthony Watson, who was standing on the shore, eyed the ship with a little gleam in his eye. Anthony was the leader of a small gang of Hastings smugglers. They imported many illegal substances, of which I've previously said tea was the most profitable due to the fact it was so heavily taxed. They were still awaiting the arrival of new troops at this point to guard them. So Anthony and his men took advantage. and clambered up the side of the ship and broke open one of the chests, number 16 apparently, and stole the 50 ingots worth something like £300,000 currently, and at the time £24 each. Nothing was noticed at that point. Meantime, other smugglers, sightseers and trophy hunters were out in force. By the Monday morning, George Warg, Collier's son-in-law, reckoned that were upward of 1,000 people on the beach, despite the gale force winds. According to him, there was still a good number of the crew on board, and they were still singing lustily while continuing to indulge in the free-flowing alcohol. It was noted that the ship had already begun to list and had sunk several inches into the clay and peat. With the salvage agreed, the men agreed to unload and guard the silver bullion, and it was at this point that the empty chest was spotted. Soon word spread about the missing bullion, and some names of the men began to spread as well, so that when a reward of £2 per ingot was made, no questions asked, 34 out of the 50 ingots were recovered. £2 was still a lot of money then. The other ingots were thought to be with Anthony, who, despite widespread searches, was never seen again. But during the time, one man at least was shot and killed, but nobody wanted to know really. So the local magistrate ruled that he'd been shot below the high water mark and so was considered to be killed at sea with no action taken. The ship sunk about 16 foot in 16 days. Within several months, the boat sunk several metres and today, as it's mentioned, 8 metres below, with an awful lot of the cargo still there. How intact? Hard to say. The first attempt at salvage came within a month afterwards when a local man, engineer Christopher Bale, tried to blow up the top deck to try and access the cargo. All he managed to do was to blow himself up at the time. The problem being with the tidal system, nobody had time to actually dig into the boat to retrieve the cargo, and this has been the problem ever since. So some of the notes that came after this, apart from the men who died of sickness, probably malnutrition as opposed to fever, it's unlikely they would have been let off the boat if they had anything serious. It's thought that they were buried at the ruined church of St Mary's because it was the nearest one and there was no record, but they wouldn't have cared too much about the names of all these wretches. Most of the people on board were returned to Holland. Captain Clamp, as I said, was cleared of all responsibility. A few of the ringleaders during the mutiny probably dispersed into England and were never heard of again. Some more salvage attempts were made in the 1800s, but all suffered the fate of the previous ones because they didn't have time to actually get into the wreck. That was until 1969. In 1969, some workmen from a company called William Grace were building a new sewer, and they thought they might do a bit of treasure hunting with one of their big excavators. So they took it and trundled it across and made three huge holes in the wreck, which was very unfortunate because they probably did an awful lot of damage as well. However, they managed to get a lot of bottles of wine out that were intact, tasted foul, but not polluted by seawater. They got cloth bales and silver lace and five bronze cannon as well. Company officials at William Grace then tried to negotiate for salvage with the local council. And at that point, Peter Marsden was called in to head up the project to see what could be done. Many of the goods that they dug up made their way to the shipwreck museum, including brushes made of heather, barrel staves, one clog, and sightseers started stealing. Nothing much had changed over the intervening centuries as people wanted their little bit of treasure from the wreck. And out of 60 to 80 bottles of wine brought out, only five made it to the shipwreck museum. Candlesticks and some human bones were found as well. There's probably more of those to be found. Following its designation as official wreck, Dutch interest in the vessel increased and the VOC Schip Amsterdam Foundation was formed to assess the feasibility of raising the hull and returning it to Amsterdam. The 1984 excavation was a much milder form with not too many finds, but an awful lot of work carried out to protect the site and also to plan for its future removal. You've seen the picture above, which is Willem, which is the current king of the Netherlands, with his mother. He's the boy on the left-hand side of the picture. So there we have it, really. The Dutch intend to build a sort of floating dock structure from which they can tow the wreck complete with sand and contents back to Amsterdam. From there, they're going to build it into an underwater museum, as shown in the pictures above, and they intend to do that by 2025. Or at least they did intend to do that. Whether the coronavirus and the new financial situation will change anything, which I suspect it will, then we may have the boat here for another good few hundred years.